So this talk is about the security analysis of Apple File Vault, specifically the version which was released by Apple in, I think, 2010, namely File Vault number 2, which is a full description feature of the Mac OS X platform. First of all, I would like to ask, who is using OS X as a primary operating system here? It's only a handful, yes, okay. So who has File Vault enabled on their disks? That's good. I will have a short introduction about the feature in a few slides. This talk will give an overview of the feature, of the implementation of it, the architecture, and also we'll also see what the security level is, which is provided by File Vault, and also take a look at some of the attacks which we found in the implementation. This is a joint research with Joachim Metz and Omar Choudhury, and of course all opinions expressed during the presentations are mine and mine alone and not the ones of my company. So our motivation for doing this research was basically that we looked at this feature and wanted to use it ourselves. And a colleague once told me that he basically reviews every single source code of every single component he runs on his operating system. I don't believe in like that he does it for all the components running on his operating system, but I think it's a good philosophy to have. If you're using some software component, you should always check the security of it. And since there was no public documentation other than some, well, Apple marketing fluff, which said it's using AES, yeah, great, and no open source forensic tools for Joachim, it was, who's one of the co-authors of the paper, it was particularly interesting to have forensic tools available for analyzing File Vault. And we actually created an open source forensic tool for everyone to use. And for me, it was particularly interesting that there is no public security review, and also the source code was not published by Apple. So it was interesting for me to see whether the security is actually up to standards and whether the security holds in TechCar and protects the user's data. It was a little bit untypical of Apple to not publish the source code because they have a philosophy of publishing the source code of the core components, and it would have been much easier and much nicer to do the security review with source code available, but well, sometimes it's not available, right? And actually the security review follows Kerckhoff's principle, which I very much like. Who has heard about Kerckhoff's principle before? That's very good, so I don't need to read it out. So this is how it looks like. It's Mac OS X, so it has a nice graphical user interface, and you click on security and you click on File Vault, and then it gives you some text and you click on turn on File Vault, and then it magically encrypts all your data of your whole disk and it's secure, right? That's how it works. For those of you who don't run OS X as their primary system. If you enable File Vault, it gives you an option, it gives you a recovery key. And this recovery key can be something like this, which is printed out there on the screen, and you're advised to write it down or print it out and keep it in a safe place. But you also have the option of attaching this recovery key to your Apple ID, which is the federated login of Apple. So you can also connect that to your Apple account, and then if you lose your recovery key, you can use your Apple ID and your password to get back your data if you forgot your password, for example. And there's also, for corporate deployments, there's also the option of deploying a certificate on the machine, and then the key is encrypted with the key from the master certificate. So a company has a company-wide certificate, for example, and then the recovery keys are all encrypted with this company-wide master certificate, but this is only for corporate deployments, not for personal usage of Mac OS X. Anyone guessing how long this AES key is? Any guesses for the length of the AES key? 1024. No, no, it's it's 128. So when you reboot your Mac machine, then you get this screen, and this is right after boot. Right after boot, you have to enter your password, and then the boot continues, and it's the disk is getting decrypted, and the machine is available to you. So when you activate FileVault, the partition layout changes. In particular, the disk has the GUID partition scheme and the EFI partition, which is responsible for the extensible firmware interface for the whole booting, for the menu. The menu code is there for displaying this password login. This stays there. This is not changed after activating FileVault. But your main volume is getting encrypted. So this is turned from an HFS plus volume into a core storage volume. And also the recovery HD volume is also not changed. But it has a particular important existence in the FileVault boot process, because the whole kernel and the recovery system for the installation of Mac OS X resides in that partition. So when you want to reinstall your machine, you can boot off that third partition here, and then you can, for example, reinstall Mac OS X or decrypt the disk and do other stuff. But it's important to note that the kernel resides in the recovery HD partition as plain text. And then, when the boot process happened, there's also the virtual disk, which is actually the core storage, the encrypted volume, decrypted. The EFI FAT partition is about 200 megabytes, and the encrypted volume has different structures in it. First, there's the core storage header, which we had to reverse engineer. Then there's a whole bunch of encrypted data. Then you find encrypted metadata in the partition and some disk label metadata. As I said before, the recovery HD contains also parts of the EFI login, some metadata in the encrypted root plist, and also some key material, as we found out later. The key material, which is residing in this recovery partition, can be looked at, and it contains a plist, which is similar to an XML file, a key value storage of all the different accounts of this system, and also it gave us the first hints for analyzing FileVault, because it contains stuff like, sorry if you cannot read this, key encrypting, key identity, user ident, key encryption, passphrase wrapped, KEK struct. So this contains some binary data, which we actually took as our starting point for analyzing FileVault and reverse engineering how it works. So we used IDA. We used a hex editor, and we used a lot of testing to actually figure out what are the moving parts here. We encrypted a disk, looked how it looks like before and after. We looked at some of the frameworks responsible, some of the libraries responsible for the encryption. We looked at the kernel extension, which does the decryption. And later out, we got to this. So I'm not going through the whole process here of how we are clicking through IDA. I'm just showing you how it actually ties in together. So if you look at this diagram, start at the top left. You take the header of the core storage volume, and also the wipe key of the encrypted root plist on the recovery volume. You put that through AES. And then you get the decrypted XML type of file for accessing the rest of the data. This plist contains a salt, and this salt comes in this password-based key derivation function, which is essentially 41,000 times SHA-256. So your password and your salt, when you boot the machine, is piped through PBKDF2, and then this key, which comes out, is then taken together with the passphrase wrapped key encryption key to the RC3394 unwrapping function, which takes one key and some plaintext data, or some well-known data, and then derives another key, which is actually the key encryption key number 2. And this key is then used for accessing the volume. So there's a volume key, which gets decrypted using the KEK2, again with key unwrapping. And then you get the volume key. And this volume key is essentially used for decrypting and encrypting your blocks. So this is essentially used for accessing the data on the disk. And the actual algorithm for accessing the data is AES-XTS 128. Who has heard about XTS before here? Okay. Yeah, it's not very well known. Yeah. But I'll explain how it works later on. There's also an alternative, as I mentioned before. You can, if you have a corporate deployment of Macs, you can deploy a certificate on the machine, and then the certificate is used to actually generate a recovery key, encrypt it, this blob right here, and then it's also piped through the unwrapping process, and then you get the key encryption key number 2 as well, so you can recover your partition if a corporate user, for example, forgets their passwords, right? So that's the alternative way. And as I mentioned before, you also have this this recovery key. This recovery key is treated like a password. So this is also just some password which is going through the same process as this right here, the password entry, then the hashing, and then the unwrapping. Okay. Anyone seeing any flaws with this scheme? That's great. So the key unwrapping, I found this rather interesting because I haven't seen the algorithm before. Basically, it's a Feistel scheme with the AES function, with the key encryption key as the round function. So you run this for the length of the key material, and then you get your encrypted key out of it. AES-XTS is actually a widely used algorithm for encrypting disks. It's used by BSD, by TrueCrypt. Who's heard about TrueCrypt before? Okay, everyone. So it's widely used, and it's kind of funny because the authors of the spec should have named it XTC, XTC, right? The first letters, XTC. But they said in the discussion mailing list, they said they cannot name it like that because it sounds too much like the drug. So they had to name it XTS. Anyways, so XTS actually stands for XOR encrypt XOR, which is an efficient way of encrypting consecutive blocks in one disk sector, but you don't have the same flaws like ECB mode. I think all of you know this picture of the penguin, which is getting encrypted with ECB mode, and then from the displayed image you can figure out it's an actual penguin. So XEX prevents that. TCB is tweaked codebook mode. This is essentially ECB with a tweaking function to circumvent similar classic attacks against ECB. And this is how it looks like. So you have the streaking function, which is some shift or some AND with the location J on the disk. And I think I is the sector. And you have your first key. You XOR this with the encryption with the first key with your tkeying function. You get C1. And then your ciphertext is actually C1 XORed with the AES encryption with your second key. And again, in there, what you're actually encrypting is C1 XORed with your actual plain text. So the streaking function lets you use some sort of ECB mode to just access a single point of data on your disk, because it would be bad if it would be CFB mode. Then you would have to decrypt a whole page before actually accessing a single bit on the disk, and this wouldn't be very effective. So an ECB mode wouldn't be secure, so they invented this. CTS is also, I find it kind of interesting because it's also about efficiency. CTS is mangling blocks together. So using that, you can circumvent padding. And if you have a AES input, 128 bit, but you want to encrypt 129 bit, you would waste, if you would be using a classic mode, you would waste 127 bits, right? And CTS actually prevents that by mangling the blocks together. And actually, the last two blocks are swapped. They are always swapped, no matter whether it's aligned or not aligned. And they're always swapped. And the tail from the second last block is then encrypted again and concatenated with the, if this is, for example, one bit here, it's concatenated with that one bit, and then encrypted again, and this becomes the last ciphertext. This makes disk usage quite efficient, because you could you only need 129 bits on disk if you want to encrypt 129 bits of plain text. Has anyone heard about this before? Okay. So when we looked at it and we looked at this whole scheme which I've shown you before and the whole algorithms which were in use, we thought, yeah, it's kind of secure, right? It's using standard algorithms, it's using AES 128. Probably no one here can brute force that, right? If you want to brute force the password, you have to break 41,000 times SHA-256 with a salt. So with the salt, you don't have any option of going with rainbow tables. It's a sufficient computation barrier, I would say. Maybe not against state-level actors, but this password hashing is probably secure against standard type of attackers. The recovery key is also kind of secure. You have to break the master certificate's RSA key. If that master certificate's RSA key deployed by the company is not sufficiently long enough, for example, 512 bits, RSA key would be too short, right? So in that case, if the company does use such certificates, then you could break it. But in usual deployments, you won't see that, right? The recovery key connected to your Apple account has some problems, right? If you consider law enforcement knocking on Apple's door or not knocking on Apple's door and asking for that key, then you might have some problems. So for usage scenarios where you are not just encrypting your iTunes library, you shouldn't probably use the Apple storage for your recovery key. The recovery key, so the third option, if you remember, is the recovery key which is displayed to you, and you should note it down. And it's actually not a 128-bit key, but it's an effective 120-bit key, because they're throwing away one byte. So let's look at this more closely, because if they're already throwing away one byte, there might be a small chance, right? So how is it generated? It's in this function right here. It's 120 bits from def-random. This is mapped into base 32 for encoding and for a human to write it down, right? Some dashes are inserted, and because of that, it's truncated to 29 chars, which is an effective bit size of 120 bits. And the user has to note it. So how is the def-random working in OS X? It's actually Counterpane's Yarrow algorithm, which has been obsoleted in 2004, I think, by Fortuna, which is a different type of random number generator, also designed by Counterpane. But OS X still uses Yarrow, and it seems to be working okay so far for them. How does it work? It's similar. It's designed similar to most of the random number generators. But when assessing a random number generator, I always take a look at the seeding first, right? So a random number generator is only as good as its seed. It's getting initialized. So we took a look at this with a kernel debugger, and it's first initialized. Then it's seeded with 8 bytes. The source is microtime. Is that a good source of entropy? No. No, right? Then the pool is recalculated. This is not actually adding to the strength of the whole random number generator. You have another input of length 20 bytes. This input is actually read from system entropy cache, which is a file on disk, which is updated every 6 hours. Then you have another input length of 256 and 72 bytes. The source for this is the function collect entropy and kdbg get entropy. These kernel functions seed the random number generator with some timing information, and this timing information is coming from the different threads which are running in the kernel, and it notes down the actual number of ticks that this thread has been running in the kernel. So since the random number generator is initialized at boot, all or most of the threads are having very low numbers for the amount of ticks which they have been running in the kernel. So the actual input is not those 300 bytes, but much lower. To assess the quality of the input here, we rebooted 100 times. I had my MacBook running like under the desk and having it in a reboot loop for 1 day. And we sampled 100 fresh install reboots. And most of the values were actually predictable. You could guess microtime and the current time, which is just the boot time, and any attacker can guess when a system has been booted, right? And since the firewall is usually activated right after installation of Mac OS X, there is no system entropy cache file. So when you install Mac OS X, there's no saved entropy cache, so the seed of that second step is actually null, right? This is after installation, this is null. And so this is also not a seed for the random number generator when generating that recovery key. And we also took a look at this MUC time spec. And as I said before, since it's just the current tick count of that kernel thread, 7 of the 8 bytes of that is null. So you could probably only count 1 byte of entropy seed right here. Since it's doing that 41 times, it's still enough, which was kind of sad for us to find out, because we wanted to find something, right? Find some vulnerability. But the estimated effective seed entropy is 320 bits, which is much harder to brute force than AES 128. So this was a dead end, and still And in live systems, the random number generator is actually good, because the system NTP cache from the last boot initializes it to a level where it's good enough. However, I do it, and I recommend to everyone to write some data to defrandom. By doing that, you actually seed the random number generator before activating your file vault to partition. So this is one of the recommendations we also do in the paper. And we think that 320 bits of entropies might be enough, but it's a little bit on the border here, right? So we still recommend that. We found a different bug, though. We dumped an image of the whole disk when activating it, and we ran we ran a tool on it to actually visualize the entropy of all the sectors of the disk. And when you visualize entropy, you, for example, color nulls in blue, you color high entropy sectors in red, and low entropy sectors in white. And we suddenly were surprised to find a stripe of low entropy data in the middle of the partition. So it was 200 megabytes of plain text data in the middle of the partition. And we thought, why didn't this get any security review? And we found out that it was a bug when the AES XDS algorithm runs for the first time and encrypts all your blocks. It left out a space of 200 megabytes, and we were kind of surprised, because my colleague who later on ran the strings tool on that data partition found out that parts of the emails to his girlfriend were actually not encrypted. So that was an oops. We reported it to Apple, and they fixed it. So if you ever activated your file vault with 10.7.0.1, you might disable it and enable it again to fix that bug. So as I said before, the keys can be stored with Apple. And this is actually the actual protection of this is your Apple ID password or SSL, because the keys are transmitted to Apple servers via SSL. If Apple SSL is broken, then these keys can be intercepted. If Apple gets broken into, or Apple is delivered a warrant, for example, then Apple probably has to comply, although it's unclear whether they actually have to. I'm not a lawyer. The Apple Transparency Report, which gives an overview of what kind of warrants and subpoenas have arrived at Apple, is rather unclear about this. It's not clear whether actually any law enforcement agency ever asked for this recovery key. And then actually the number of law enforcement requests to them is rather low. It's 100 for Germany and about 5,000 for US. I recommend not to use that feature for corporate deployments. If you have a Mac fleet, which you have to manage, there's a tool called Cauliflower West, which I'll give a link to later. It's a tool which takes this recovery key, which is generated, and sends it to your own server. You can store it on your own servers and do not depend on Apple to keep it safe. There's also the attack vector of the evil mate. The evil mate, I think it's a term dubbed by Joanna. It's essentially the attack vector that you leave your laptop in a building, you leave your laptop at the hotel, and the attacker approaches your laptop, does something with it, or an evil mate approaches your laptop and does something with it, and then replace the hardware, for example, and then you leak your password to the bugged hardware, for example. These attacks are still possible. For example, you can open the drive, then replace. You just have to unscrew this, right? So it might take half an hour or so. Then you replace the kernel or the EFI code. And because that code was not, there's no trusted boot there, so that code is not verified at all, You can insert your own backdoor to, for example, lock the password to a file or send the password to a server when the device has booted. So this is there's no prevention against that. Or the attacker could boot via USB and replace the kernel or the EFI code, which is the user interface for entering the password. This boot via USB can be mitigated by the firmware by setting a boot password, similar to a BIOS password. However, the BIOS password or the Apple BIOS password can be reset in a Mac store. I tried to reverse engineer this, but I didn't quite get it how they do it. But so any Apple employee or every Apple store can reset that BIOS password. And also the NVRAM where the BIOS password is stored can be read out by an attacker having physical access to the device. So this shouldn't be good protection either. It's just another, well, it's five more minutes of work on the side of the attacker. Also, if you reuse the firmware password in the system with a system password, and these are both the same, the attacker doesn't have to do anything, right? there's a possibility of ODAY, which disables the screensaver. So if you have your laptop locked and you're, for example, entering a new country, there's the possibility that the that a USB hot plugging or any sort of physical access event with the locked screensaver can disable the screensaver by exploiting some USB driver in the kernel and then getting code execution on the device to kill the screensaver. There's this possibility, and on older Mac OS X releases, it was also possible to do remote DMA, where you plug in a DMA device, FireWire or IEEE 1394 device, into the laptop, and then modify the memory directly to, for example, crash the screensaver and access the laptop, or read out the encryption keys from the RAM. Right? And the cold boot attacks, which were demonstrated in, I think, 2008. Who's heard about cold boot before? Okay, so where you freeze actually the memory and then remove it from the hardware to plug it in into another machine to read out the memory again. These attacks are possible in the first 70 minutes, according to Apple, because after that they go into some sort of hibernate state where you have to reboot the machine. And before that, the keys are actually still existent in RAM, but after that, they are removed from RAM. So, in the end, it's a good full disk encryption feature, which is also coming for free with Mac OS X. So, it's still much better than a good portion of the commercial products out there. So, it's definitely good to activate it and use it. But you should be wary of the different attack vectors I presented to you today. So the bad seeding of the defrandom can be mitigated by just writing some data, some entropy data to the defrandom device, and then you have a good RNG in the system before activating FileVault. The vulnerability with the 200 megabytes of plaintext has been fixed. Don't do the key escrow with Apple. I think it's common sense even. Then you should be wary of the different attacks which can be done by highly skilled attackers. For example, the evil mail, the code boot, or the unlock ODAY. But in order to defend against such attacks, you have to have good operational security anyways. So yes, that's my summary. The references is basically our paper. There you can see all the technical details. If you ever want to work on forensic analysis of OS X, then I recommend this library. This is basically a tool and a library to decrypt volumes and access them, and it works with the latest releases. If your thing is corporate Mac management, then I can recommend Cauliflower Vest, which is the key escrow similar to Apple's key escrow, but to your own server, where you can store your key material there. And also these Usenix talks. OS X Hardening and managing Macs. These are very good further pointers if you want to harden your Mac OS X installation against attacks. I really recommend these ones here. Okay, that's it. Thanks for your attention, and if you have any questions or comments, I would be happy to take them.